Thank you. story. It's actually mentioned in all four of the Gospels. And it's one of the followers of Jesus. Her name was Mary, and she had come out of a pretty terrible lifestyle. And she was following Jesus and followed Jesus the rest of her days. Became a prominent person in the group that followed Jesus. But there was something significant that she did at one time. This was 6 days before the Passover celebration began. I'm reading in John chapter 12. Jesus arrived in Bethany, the home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from the dead. A dinner was prepared in Jesus' honor, and Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who ate with him. Then Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume made from the essence of nard, and she anointed Jesus' feet with it, wiping his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance. But Judas Iscariot, the disciple who would soon betray Jesus, said, "That perfume was worth a year's wages. It should have been sold and the money given to the poor." Not that he cared for the poor. He was a thief, and since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole some for himself. Jesus replied, "Leave her alone. She did this in preparation for my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." This significant thing that she did, understanding the worth of Jesus. Now, that jar of oil was about a year's wages. So think about a year's wages in our terms being used and poured out as an expensive perfume on the feet of a person, on the feet of Jesus. And what we don't understand, or what some of us don't connect, is in that culture, the feet were the dirtiest part of a person. There was typically all types of manure and feces and gross things all throughout the streets, and they had open sandals. And then it was typical as they would enter into the room that you had to wash your feet because your feet were disgusting. And here she takes and pours out this most expensive perfume, this offering upon Jesus' feet, honoring him. And it's very typical in our humanistic and in our mind of man to think, well, that's just a waste. But in context, when Jesus says, "I want you to love me with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind, and all of your strength," there is no offering too great to be lavished upon Jesus. And for us to hold back, or for us to allow our thoughts to come to a place where I'm just going to give Jesus this over here that I maybe set aside, or I'm just going to give him what will make me feel comfortable, or I'm just going to give him what I think might make him happy, instead of just lavishing him with our gratitude and our offering, our thanksgiving, our prayer, our life, our attitudes, our minds, our mouths, every part of our life. Paul tells us in Romans that our body is literally the sacrifice that he desires. And that, it goes on to say that that is the way that we worship God, is with our body. With every part of our being. It's not just a song. It's not just a portion of our paycheck. It's, we need to learn how to bring Jesus our everything. Because he's worthy of our everything. And he will take that and he will magnify the gift. He will magnify it because his heart is to bless us. His heart is to bring us into the glory. To share his glory with us. But if we're holding back, if we're We're robbing ourselves of his fullness. He paid for us to be full. He paid for us to live full. And when we don't come into agreement and say, okay, Jesus, everything I am, I give it to you. Every part of my life, I'm giving it to you. I'm surrendering. And I know it's a process, guys. And right now, today, there's something that the Lord wants you to find in the surrendering today. He's doing it for me, too. Might just be a negative thought. It might be that thought that, well, I can't really give God that because then I won't have enough for me. I think that's the most ridiculous thought that we as human beings could ever have. That we could somehow outgive God. Or that we could somehow not come into the agreement with the promise that says that he is our provider and he will meet our every need. So I want us to come today with an offering to the Lord that comes from our heart, comes from a place of fullness, where we recognize all that he has done, and we want to respond to him with exuberant praise, an exuberant response of gratitude and thanksgiving, and to bring our lives as an offering to him today. Can we do that today? Yes. To Jesus, this is worthy. So we're going to worship the Lord in our tithes and offerings. We have buckets up front. And this is where you get to really communicate with God. What are you asking me of, Lord? What are you desiring? Where is my heart at? What place in my life are you asking me to step in, to trust you, to surrender to you? How can I bring you the greatest level of glory right now in my life, right now in this moment? What is that thing that I've held back from you, or that I thought that if I give that up, then I won't have any for myself, or if I won't, I don't know how I'll survive, or I don't know how I'll get through. If our life is truly in Jesus, guys, then why aren't we going all the way in him? Why aren't we taking our life and absolutely burying every aspect of it in him? If our life is only in Christ, the truest life, the greatest life that we can live is buried in him.
Yes.
So let's bring him an offering this morning. Let's pour it out upon his feet. Let's lavish him with our praise. Let's lavish him with our with the right kind of thoughts. Let's use our bodies as an instrument of worship today. Thank you.
our healing. He is our truth. He is our faith. Like, he is our hope. He is everything. He is our peace. When we start to believe that, it's really easy to be grateful. It's really easy to bow down low before the Lord. He's so good. He's so good. Good, he really is. We've only tasted and seen how good he is, but he's
won for us through this victory over sin, victory that won us our freedom, victory over death in the grave, victory over the enemy, that he has made us more than conquerors. Let's worship him in communion right now. If you're here as families, I encourage you to take this time to teach your children about why we take communion. That this is about Jesus paying the price for our sin, our wrongs. He's come that we would be free, that our joy would be made full, and we would live life to the fullest. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. No other one.
Come on!
No other one can do what you are. You're the perfect sacrifice, Jesus. You are our champion. Thank you. so much power, so much that we still have to discover about what Jesus has done for us. So we get to do it again today. Amen? Amen. If you're here with little ones, I want to just give you some quick instructions. We do have a nursery area, but it's not currently being attended by an overseer. So if you have little ones, you're welcome to go in there. We'll be live streaming the service in there. But please don't leave your children in there unattended. We are praying, as the Lord provides, to be able to have nursery attendance in the near future. But until then, we're really wanting to support families and grow families together in the Lord. If you have older children, you can have some activity books, some coloring things while during the message. And so I'll tell you what, it's good to be back. We had a wonderful time in the sun, a relaxing time. The Lord really ministered to us and refreshed us. But I missed worship. I missed you guys. I missed being here. And so we're glad to be back. We're thankful to have had a wonderful time, but good to be back. So a couple announcements before I'm going to have my dad come and speak. I'm actually really excited to hear today's message. It's been stirring in me because he didn't get to speak it last week. So he sent me the notes and everything over a week ago. So I'm like, all right. So I'm really anticipating what the Holy Spirit has. Through him. A couple announcements. One of them is we are having baptisms this month. Today is March 1st, so this month, on the 26th, Thursday night the 26th, we're having baptisms here. It is going to be an event. It will be a part of our Elevate Recovery Thursday night. It'll pretty much just take up the whole time. But if you have a desire to be baptized, we do have a sign-up sheet in the back that you can go ahead and sign your name. If you are planning on being baptized, please bring a towel and a change of clothes. We do try and dark-colored clothing. Yeah, we want to just keep it PG here. So so we do provide some towels, but we ask that you maybe bring one from home that you can help support, because we like to get wet here. During baptism. So, other thing I want you to know about is Elevate 2 coming up this month as well. We want you to be, if you're not already signed up, to get signed up, but specifically if you've already attended Elevate 1. So there's, Elevate 2 is amazing, but if you don't have Elevate 1, you're not going to really be able to grasp hold of or really take hold of all that Elevate 2 has to offer. So if you've attended Elevate 1, we want you to get signed up if you're not. There's information in the back on that. Remind me of the date.
This Saturday.
This next Saturday, yeah. So, which is the 8th, right? Or is it the 7th? Okay. So the 7th, so this next following Saturday is Elevate 2. So if you haven't got signed up, you can get signed up still if you attended Elevate 1. If you're excited about Elevate 1, so are we. But we will be teaching that again in the fall. So watch for that. It will most likely be in September. We're really trying to get as many people involved as we can and give the time for people to get signed up. So Elevate 1 is September, but Elevate 2 is next Saturday. Come on.
All right.
Okay. Actually, do we have that video ready? Let's just start with that. I mean, mean that in a good way. Because it was planted in my spirit 20 years ago as I was doing groups on Wednesday and Thursday night for Serenity Lane. And God showed up. God showed up because we were confessing to one another. And I just stepped back and I said, wow. It was a Wednesday night, and I said, you know what? This is more church than is happening in the churches. This is real. This is what God will show up to. We're practicing James 5:16 so that healing can happen. Amen? What happens when God shows up? Miracles happen. This is a move. So that's what I shared with them. You know what? It's a move. It's a movement, right? Chris has said that, Steve. He says, whoa, crazy things are happening. It's a movement.
Yeah, come on.
It's a movement. Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe. Yes, we can see it. That wonders. And then probably one of the most favorite recent ones is, you are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God!
Restored lives restore others.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So restoration and transformation. So let's just start. We're going to go through these quickly. So are you ready?
Yes.
Buckle up. Here we go. This is out of Isaiah 35. The desert and the parched land will be glad.
Yeah.
The wilderness will rejoice and blossom like the crocus. And even getting out crocuses and daffodils popping up right and left. Yeah. It will burst into bloom. And that's exactly what happens. You almost watch them push through. I've seen them even come through snow.
Yeah, amen.
And I love it because it's talking about the land. And listen to what it says. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy.
Yeah.
See? The land is transformed.
Yeah.
And shouts for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to the splendor of Carmel and Sharon, and they will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Again, land. We have that picture? Yeah. Look at some of those trees. Some of those trees are so massive. It showed a picture of a guy in the corner of one of the limbs, and he was dwarfed by the limb. That wasn't the trunk. He was just dwarfed. It was just huge. This is a forest, the largest Lebanon cedar forest. And God says it's going to be restored even more to more places. All right. This is Isaiah 60. Part of the things that come with it is the nourishment. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. Isaiah 60, verse 7. And then in 13 it says, again, Lebanon's glory will be yours. They just said that in 35, right?
Yeah.
The cypress, the fir, and the pine will come to you. Wow. And then in 41, same verbiage, same language. Transformation. Amen?
Amen?
Listen, I will open up refreshing streams on the barren hills and springing fountains in the valleys. I will make the desert a pleasant pool, the dry land springs of water. I will plant in treeless desert cedars and acacia and myrtle and olive trees. I will plant in the treeless. There should have been a problem there. So cedars and acacia and myrtle and olive trees. By the way, do you know that myrtle trees only grow in two places? Guess where? Israel and here in Oregon. Whoa! Check that out! Think about that for a minute. Yeah! Wow, there's more. There's more. That's Isaiah 41. And then in 51, indeed, Yahweh will comfort Zion. Who knows who Zion refers to?
The church.
Yes, that's the New Jerusalem. The church. Yahweh will comfort Zion, restore her, and comfort her in all of her broken places. He will transform her wilderness into a garden of bliss.
Yeah.
How many want to make a garden of bliss?
Yeah.
He will her desert into a garden of Yahweh. Joy and laughter will fill the air with thanksgiving and joyous melodies. That's why I like it when we're out here. You know?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You like it? What God is doing in our lives, and you know, this isn't just about pointing to Sunday morning. It's all, let's give it all we got. No, we're celebrating what God's been doing all week. Amen. Yes. All right, back to my notes. I gotta keep going. This is Isaiah 66. I will extend to her prosperity like a river. Everybody say, like a river.
Like a river.
Zion, the New Jerusalem, is where we enter God's presence. For we are not coming, as Moses did, to a physical mountain with burning fire and thick clouds of darkness and gloom. We put away gloom, right? By contrast, we have already come near to God. Everybody say, we have already come.
We have already come.
See, this isn't in the future, this is now. We have already come to a God totally different.
Amen.
To a totally different God realm. The Zion realm. Everybody say Zion realm.
Zion realm.
Yeah, we're in it. For we have entered the city of the living God, which is the New Jerusalem in heaven. We have joined the festal gathering of myriads of angels. By the way, you know what a myriad is? 10,000. And it says 10,000 times 10,000. Go and put that on the calculator. There's too many zeros that won't work on most of them. Lots of zeros.
Yeah.
All right? Myriads of angels. I always remind Satan that he only took a third and he's outnumbered 2-1.
Right?
Right? All right. For we have joined the festal gathering of myriads of angels in joyous celebration. And as members of the Church of the Firstborn, all of our names have been legally registered as citizens of heaven. Or you say, put your hand on your chest. I'm a citizen of heaven.
I'm a citizen of heaven.
Wow.
I'm legally registered.
Yeah. Yeah. We're registered. We're in. Amen. And we have come before God who judges all and who lives among the spirits of the righteous who have been made perfect in his eyes. We're surrounded, by the way. Did you know that? Hebrews says we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. And they're cheering us on. And they're saying, come on! You can do it! I made it! You can too! Sometimes I feel it. Sometimes I see it. Yes, thank you, Lord. We have come to Jesus. When Jesus shows up, what happens? Everything changes. Miracles happen. Healing will come. We have come to Jesus who established a new covenant with his blood, sprinkled on the mercy seat, blood that continues to speak from heaven, forgiveness. And it never stops. For we have joined the festal gathering of myriads of angels in joyous celebration. We have something to sing about!
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Worship. By the way, this week, I had a new download. Somebody sent me a clip that says, my worship is a warship.
Yeah.
And my weapon is a melody. Goes right with it. I said that to Anna. Because that's her song, she said it. So what happens when God shows up? Transformation happens. Get used to different. Healed, saved, and set free. This is in Isaiah 53. And this is, we've been talking about the land being changed. Now let's talk about people, all right? Yeah. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened. This is back in 35, and then we'll go to 53. The eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout for joy. Things happen. Miracles happen. Yes, yet he was the one who carried our sicknesses, endured the torment of our sufferings. He endured the punishment that made us completely whole. And in his wounding, we found our healing. By his wounds, we are healed. By the way, that scripture is fulfilled in Matthew chapter 8, 16 and 17. Jesus heals in Capernaum after Peter's mother-in-law was healed. And it said that everyone that came, well, just listen to the verse. That evening, the people brought to him many who were demonized. And by Jesus only speaking a word of healing over them, they were totally set free. Just a word. And everyone who was sick received their healing. In doing this, Jesus fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. He put himself on our weaknesses, and he carried away our diseases and made us well. So there's a book Christy and I read a few years ago called The Cure. What happens when God shows up? Everything gets cured.
Yeah.
All right? When God shows up, the beings that hear his image the beings that bear his image are restored, including the land. The world he made is rebooted. The ears of the deaf, the eyes of the blind, the tongues of the mute, the feet of the lame, all are healed. Creation is restored. People are healed. That's what it looks like when God shows up. Amen. Thank you. Now, what's interesting is Jesus calls that what? The kingdom of God. Yeah, it's the kingdom of God. And when John the Baptist asked about him, here's what John asked. Are you the one? They've been waiting. Are you the one? Did you see Nicodemus in that clip?
Yeah.
Wait. For so long. By the way, the other day I was in Primark and I was picking up something, I don't remember what it was, and I saw an obvious Jew and an Orthodox one because he not only had the little cap, but he also had the long curled sideburns. I thought, and God said, go talk to him. I thought, okay, here we go. I had to kind of chase him down and found him on the aisle, and he was grabbing something. I said, excuse me, sir, I noticed that you obviously are an Orthodox Jew, and I'm a Christian, and I just want to ask you some things. I'm really interested not only in the Hebrew language, but we love the celebrations that happen in the Old Covenant. And I believe they are a picture, and we can still celebrate those. And I'm really looking for more information to dig in to some of the Hebrew words. And so he said, there's lots of apps and things like that. So I started talking to him, and I said, I'd love to talk to him. He says, well, I'm on my way to Israel. I'm moving there.
Wow.
And I said, I've heard that there's like over 20 million Jews that have moved back.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that number is a lot larger now.
Yes.
Awesome.
You guys, in Romans 9:10, it says that when the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled, the Jews are going to accept Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
They're looking for the Messiah to come. And here's what I believe. I believe God is going to use their hardened hearts that has happened over the last thousands of years and reveal himself to them right now before he comes back. Because it says the Jews are going to come to Christ.
Yes.
And I just thought, man, I've got to say something. And I said, so I'm really a passionate follower of Christ, and I just want to appeal to you to really look for him and ask God to reveal himself to you in that. But he's already come for you.
Yes.
And I was kind of expecting, and it wasn't. There's a tenderness in heart.
Yeah.
So God, I just pray for that man that I met in, yes, to accept Christ and for more to come.
Yeah.
More to come. The blind receive sight. The lame walk. Those who have leprosy are cleansed. The deaf hear. The dead are raised. And the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Matthew 11, 2 through 6. Jeremy talked about Mary this morning about how she worshiped at the feet of Jesus, pouring on that wonderful aroma of worship on his feet. And I love the clip in The Chosen of her saying, I was one way, and now I'm completely different, and the only thing that happened in between was him. Get used to different. It's in the Great Commission. These miracle signs will accompany those who believe. They will drive out demons in the power of my name. They will speak in tongues. They will be supernaturally protected from snakes and anything poisonous. By the way, I believe that's talking about demons. And they will lay hands on the sick and heal them. Mark 16, 17. Conclusion, when God shows up, everything changes. Yeah. It's just like in recovery, right? It says, so you only need to change one thing. Everything. Amen. Amen. See, here's the thing though. He wants to show up for you and me personally. He wants to reveal himself to each one of us that way, the same way he did to Mary. Each one of us, he wants to show up so that transformation and restoration happens in your life. So, tell you a quick little story about my friend Bob. So when Christy and I were in Eastern Oregon, we had kind of stepped off the bus, so to speak. Moved away from Portland, where we were going like gangbusters. And I know you can't believe this, but I wore a suit 7 days a week then. I did. Not anymore. Things changed. And in fact, it was pretty funny because I show up. This, you guys, our church was in Imbolc. How big of a town was that? Maybe a couple hundred people. Finally, he came to me and said, "Grandma, lose the tie." So anyway, we met some people. I actually met Bob's wife first at our bank, and I knew there was something different. And so I said, "Marla, you're a Christian, aren't you?" And she said, "Yes." And so we connected and we started doing things together. But Bob, all he talked about was golf, which was okay for me because in my other life, I used to golf a lot. All right? So I had to go to work. And so that was good. You know, it was great. We talked about golf and I tried to talk about Jesus a little bit and we kind of change the subject back to golf, and who he was teaching, and all the different things. So we met a few times, and then one time, Christy and I went to Walmart, and Bob walked out. And Bob looked different. Bob looked different. His face was glowing. And he had a big grin on his face. And it just popped out. I said, "Bob, what happened to you?" And he said, "I met Jesus." Yeah. Now, what was amazing is Bob was a churchgoer. Regular. Yeah. And he hadn't met Jesus yet. And I said, "Well, tell me about it." So then he told me about this retreat and how he and Marla had gone, and it was amazing. And I said,
I want to go. If it did for you, I want some of that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then when we see Jesus, another, you know, we kind of go, whoa, okay. So we went. Well, actually, I went first. And Christy didn't like that. Because we do everything together. But it was okay. And I went. And I didn't look the same afterwards.
Yes.
Either.
Thank you, Lord.
Because I met Jesus.
Amen.
Guys, I've been a pastor for 12 years. How's that happen? How do we miss him? We get tied up, caught up. You just doing.
Yeah.
Doing. We need to be the church that God has called to be. Transformed and restored.
Yeah.
Transformed and restored. And I can tell you, I haven't been the same since.
Of
course. I haven't been the same since. I scared Christy when I came back. I was acting really weird, really young. We'll just leave it at that. Praise Jesus. But it changed me. It changed me because I saw Jesus in a whole new way. And when Jesus shows up, everything changes. Everything changes. I believe that's why God brought us here.
Yes.
I truly believe that with all my heart. That God brought us back over here so that we can join the transformation and restoration that is happening in Roseburg, in Douglas County.
Yes.
And in the state of Oregon. That will sweep across the nation.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I want to say one more thing, because this is still about personally. Everybody put your hand on your heart. So this is a picture of what happened to me. And you all have a choice, all right? There's a story about a king named Asa in 2 Chronicles 16. And he started out really well. And the story, the scripture says, at that time you relied on the Lord. And he handed everything over to you. And the scripture says this, the eyes of the Lord search through the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. One of the translations says, show Himself strong. Everybody say, show Himself strong.
Show Himself strong.
Show yourself strong, Lord.
Show yourself strong. Come on.
Yeah.
And
at that time, in September of 1994, Christy and I both said, pick me.
Pick me.
Pick us.
Woo.
Today, I'm challenging you. This is not a close yet because we have some good news about Roseburg and Douglas County. I'm challenging each of you to say, pick me.
Pick me,
Lord. Strengthen me. Show yourself strong to me so that I am transformed and restored. Because this is who we are. That morning, the Lord told me to go to Isaiah 58. Now this passage has been prophetically spoken and shared with us three times. So this was the fourth time. I said, okay, Lord, I got it. And this passage is amazing. And I just want to read 6 through 14, and then we're going to make some declarations. And this is one of the titles.
titles that I heard about this passage is The City Where God Lives. All right? The City Where God Lives. We set free the crushed and mistreated. We break off every yoke of bondage. We share our food with the hungry. We provide for the homeless and bring them into our home. We clothe the naked and we don't turn our back on our own flesh and blood. Our favor bathes us in sunlight. We're like the dawn bursting through a dark night. Suddenly, healings manifest. I love that. We see His righteousness march out before us. And the glory of Yahweh protects us from all harm. Yahweh answers when we pray, and when we cry out for help, He says, I'm here. We banish every form of oppression and scornful accusations and vicious slander. We're done with that.
Right?
We banish it. We offer ourselves in compassion for the hungry to relieve those in misery because of this. And suddenly, our dawning light rises in the darkness, and our gloom turns into noonday splendor. Yahweh always shows up. Always, everybody say, always.
Always.
Always shows us where to go and what to do. He fills us with refreshment, even when we're in a dry and difficult place. How many of you find yourself in a dry and difficult place sometimes? God shows up, and He fills you with refreshment. He completely restores our strength. We flourish like a well-watered garden, like an ever-flowing, trustworthy spring of blessing. We're rebuilding long-deserted ruins.
Whoa.
Yeah. Yeah. Generational.
Yeah.
Generational. Just talking about people. Foundations laid long before. We are known as repairers of the cities, restorers of the communities. We have stopped pursuing our own desires, or serving our own interests, or speaking empty words. We only speak life. We have found the joyous bliss that comes from serving Jesus. Suddenly, He's caused us to prosper. Yes, yes, yes. That's not the message. I love that. We are tearing triumphantly over the high places in the land. And we enjoy the heritage of Jacob, our ancestor.
Amen.
Certainly, the mouth of Yahweh has spoken.
Yeah.
Certainly. So, this is who we are. And this is what God is doing today in Roseburg. So I want to make some declarations. So let's stand up. And let's say these together. These are right out of the scripture, and I believe that God is doing this, and you'll hear it in these declarations. And the first one is, we are a drug-free city. Say that.
We are a drug-free city.
Set free.
Set free.
And no bondage.
No bondage.
No homelessness.
No homelessness.
We have compassion.
Food for hungry.
We provide for the homeless.
We provide for the homeless.
We're bringing them into homes.
Healings manifest.
Suddenly.
Suddenly.
Answered prayers.
Answered
prayers. God always say, I'm here.
God always says, I'm here.
Oppression, accusation, and slander are banished.
Oppression, accusation, and slander are banished.
More personal. I banish.
Oppression.
Accusation.
Amen.
We have direction.
We have direction.
God always shows up. We flourish.
We flourish.
Stretch out our arms and bless.